Welcome students to the second session of the chapter The Ailing Planet, The Green Movement's Role. We had earlier done few questions regarding when and where did this green movement begin, how was it important, what is the concept of sustainable development, how human beings are responsible to bring ruckus on this earth, how we are shareholders, partners, caretakers, but not owners of this planet. What are the earth's principal biological systems? And how are human beings causing harm to those principal biological systems? What are the effects? We had done that. And we had left page number 45, para 1 we had done. After that, we have to do our remaining questions today. The first thing that comes in our mind is, why is the author so bothered about forests being cut? And after reading this, you will understand, we think that yes, trees are being cut everywhere and they are cut in huge numbers. But after seeing this statistics, we understand from inside, we understand how much harm is being caused to the earth as the huge number of trees are being decimated, cut in huge numbers. So let us see how this statistic goes. It has been well said that forests precede mankind, deserts follow. A very famous saying, and that same famous saying says that forests precede mankind. Before mankind came, there were plenty of forests. After mankind came, the forests started to disappear. Forests precede mankind, deserts follow. Because after that, if forests are removed, then that place will turn into barren. It will turn into wasteland. And it will turn into a desert. The world's ancient patrimony of tropical forests is now eroding at the rate of 40 to 50 million acres a year. Just understand what the statistic goes. It says 40 to 50 million acres in 1 year the forests are being cut. And the growing use of dung for burning deprives the soil of an important natural fertilizer. Yes, this is the next problem. We say, no, to add fuel to the fire. The fire is already burning. You add fuel to it, it will burn all the more. That means what? The situation is already acute. And human beings make it all the more worse. The reason? The dung with the cow dung or the dung of the animals, which can prove itself as a good fertilizer. People are using it as a fuel. And as they are using it as a fuel, the earth is deprived of minerals. Then, the World Bank estimates that a five-fold increase in the rate of forest planting is needed to cope with the expected fuel wood demand in the year 2000. And we are already in the year 2020. By the time this article was written, Nani Palkhivala was an author who has thought about the future. And talking about 2000, he said five-fold increase. Now in 2020, it has to be more than that. Earlier it was said, plant one. If you cut one tree, you have to plant one. Now they say, cut one tree, plant five. 2020, it is all the more. Now the next thing that comes in our mind, are rules not there? Rules are there, but the problem with the rules, let us see. Article 48A of the Constitution. You have to remember, Article 48A of the Constitution of India provides that the state shall endeavor, state means the country, the state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forest and wildlife of the country. Now here it is the responsibility of the government. The government has to see that the flora and the fauna both are kept intact. Okay, but what causes endless anguish is the fact that laws are never respected nor enforced in India. There is a very good example which is given. For instance, the Constitution says that casteism, untouchability and bonded labor shall be abolished. But they flourish shamelessly even after 44 years of the operation of the Constitution. You have to understand there is a word ignominious. Ignominious means shameful. And what is the thing of ignominy here? That even after so many years of constitution, these all malpractices are prevalent. Who will bother about the environment? And that is why people hardly take care. The problem is rules are never respected nor enforced in India. Then, a recent report of our Parliament's Estimates Committee has highlighted the near catastrophic depletion, a very good word indeed, catastrophic, disastrous, which is on the verge of getting over, okay? catastrophic depletion of India's forest over the last 4 decades. India, according to reliable data, is losing its forest at the rate of 3.7 million acres a year. Large areas officially designated as forest land are already virtually treeless. In the map it is shown, this particular area is forest land, and when you visit there, you'll find not even a tree over there. The reason? The forests have been cleared. In papers they are shown, but actual thing, they are virtually treeless. The actual loss of forest is estimated to be about 8 times the rate indicated by government statistics. They say India is losing 3.7 million acres in 1 year. But actual data says 8 times. You multiply 3.7 by 8. Those many million acres we as Indians are losing the forest. This is the truth. And by the time that article is written and by the time we are studying it in 2020, we understand the situation would have become all the more acute. Now, what is the major problem? Overpopulation. Let us see what is the growth of the world population, and this chapter provides you good statistics and data regarding the growth of the world population. Okay, we should keep in mind 1994 this article was written and published, and here we find 2020 situation would have become all the more worse, as I said. Now, a 3-year study using satellites and aerial photography conducted by the United Nations warns that the environment has deteriorated so badly that it is critical in many of the 88 countries investigated. By the time 88 countries were investigated, and we found that the situation has become acute. In India also we see it. The amount of smog that is coming. Like every time in winters, people face this particular problem because of pollution. People blame many other people regarding that, but they never understand they themselves are a part to the crime. We have to remember that mirror of Lusaka. Then, there can be no doubt that the growth of world population is one of the strongest factors distorting the future of human society. It took mankind more than 1 million years to reach the first billion. See the statistics? 1 million years to get 1 billion. Another 100 years, 1 more billion added. So in 1 million years we turned 1 billion, another 100 years another 1 billion was added. And then what? It took mankind more than 1 million years to reach the first billion. That was the world population around the year 1800. By the year 1900, a second billion was added. That means 100 years. And the 20th century has added another 3.7 billion. 1 million years, 1 billion. 100 years, another billion. And just 100 years, 3.7 billion were added to the existing two. Then, the present world population is estimated around 5.7 billion. Every 4 days, the world population increases by 1 million. This is the truth. Every 4 days, 1 million people are added. Then, fertility falls as income rises, education spreads, and health improves. Yes, of course. When we become all the more advanced, we get all the more educated, we have more income, we understand we should have less number of children so that we can maintain the health and plus the prosperity of those children who are there. Because we should not follow that order. More the hands, more the income. That's not so. Thus, development is the best contraceptive which can keep control on the population is development. But development itself may not be possible if the present increase in number continues. See the irony. So interrelated. It's a vicious circle. You don't know from where to break it. We say that development acts as a contraceptive, but development itself is not possible till the huge number is there. How to control the huge number? Development first or population control first? Then the rich get richer and the poor beget children, which condemns them to remain poor. More children does not mean more workers, merely more people without work. It is not suggested that human beings be treated like cattle and compulsorily sterilized, but there is no alternative to voluntary family planning without introducing an element of coercion. Coercion means force. A very good word, students. Unless people are forced, something is made mandatory, population control will never be taken care of. Then, the choice is really between control of population and the perpetuation of poverty. The population of India is estimated to be 920 million today, more than the entire population of Africa and South America put together. No one familiar with the conditions in India would doubt that the hope of the people would die in hungry hutments unless population is given utmost priority. All governments these many years, they have been just having programs regarding the control on population. But how many times have these programs been properly implemented? Unless this population would be controlled, this growing number would be controlled, India would never be able to progress. So development, population, both are interrelated. Then, for the first time in human history, we see a transcending concern with the green population, with the green movement. First time, a transcending concern. And what is that concern? The survival not just of the people, but of the planet. Planet also will die. It's a living being, it will also die. We have begun to take a holistic view of the very basis of our existence. The environmental problem does not necessarily signal our demise. Demise means end, death. It is our passport for the future. The emerging new world vision is assured in the era of responsibility. Major thing. Today we need to understand our responsibility. Everybody has to. Government, politicians, common people, industrialists, everybody, they should not say it is not our responsibility. Then, it is a holistic view, an ecological view, seeing the world as an integrated whole rather than dissociated collection of parts. We should not say, these are industrialists, here are the politicians, here are the common man. Okay? Then we say, it's these people in different groups. No, all have to work together towards the benefit of the environment. Industry has a most crucial role to play in the new era of responsibility. What a transformation would it be affected if more businessmen shared the view of the chairman of DuPont, Mr. Edward S. Bullard, who 5 years ago declared himself to be the company's chief environmental officer. He said, our continued existence as a leading manufacturer requires that we excel in environmental performance. Why have the habit? I said CEO, chief executive officer. But he said, I rather be called the chief environment officer because I wish to take care of the environment also, along with seeing that our industry develops. That means mechanistic to holistic. With that we began the chapter, same thing we are ending the chapter with. See the last paragraph. Of all the statements made by Margaret Thatcher during the years of her prime ministership, none has passed so decisively into the current coin of English usage as her felicitous words. No generation has a free hold on this earth. Very beautiful lines. No generation has a free hold on this earth. We are not owners. All we have is a life tenancy with a full repairing lease. He said, she said, we have taken this earth on lease. Lease, we understand, if by chance we have purchased a property, we have given some amount to the person, as soon as we give the property to that person, we get our amount back. And we have to hand over the property as it is. Similarly, we are merely caretakers and trustees of this earth. In the words of Mr. Lesser Brown, we have not inherited this earth from our forefathers. We have borrowed it from our children. We have to give this earth back to the children as it is. That means which concept should be maintained now and given utmost priority is sustainable development. Use the present resources, but leave something for the next generation also. So this is how we understand. We have done today the importance of tropical forests. We have done today how much the tropical forests are being decimated. What is the role played by the government and what should be done? What is the problem with the laws in India? What is the problem with the world population? What is the growth of the world population? How is this world population affecting the environment? And what is this era of responsibility? So in all, we have done 8 questions over here. Okay, thank you.